figured it out. I was not pressing on something, and I had to go with my phone, because guess what? StreamYard will not work with my webcam anymore, but other things do. I don't know what's going on with that.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I had to go live because we're so late.
That's okay. Go ahead. Yeah, you're fine.
Yeah, so our topic is writing children's books and how to get them in order and ready to be published, and then to publish them, right?
Right, definitely. I will be excited to hear, like, you can pick up where you were talking. I'm going to try and share the video as you're talking then.
Okay. Now, you know, you and I were talking about a different book, Banned from Lunch, the other day. But that book hasn't really been published yet, and I still have to work on the manuscript. So I thought tonight we'd talk about a book that has, in fact, been published more than once, and that way we'll be able to share the entire experience. Do you think that's okay?
I think that would be great. I like In Case There's a Fall, actually. It's a great book.
Okay, thank you. I'm glad you do. I'm going to try now to see if I can share this on Twitter.
Okay.
And you go ahead and share it elsewhere because we are live.
Yeah, that's what I was going to do. I was going to go to your main page and go ahead and share it. I think it's great that Aya has written a children's book. And one thing I was going to say that I really like about it is that she has her own publishing company and that she had all this creative control over it. Because I've heard the experiences of people who want to write a children's book and they go to a publisher, and sometimes it's not very satisfactory, but I love that you created this wonderful book, and I think it would be a great resource. I actually was really disappointed because I sent it to a teacher who I'm kind of friends with, and she said she was going to tell me if another teacher used it, but then she never got back to me, so I don't know what happened with that.
Well, it's very hard to get feedback sometimes.
Yeah.
And now I cannot even get on to the network with my other computer. It just does weird things sometimes.
Yeah.
So maybe I'll ask you to share it on Twitter and to tag me on Twitter so that my.
Yeah, for sure. Look, I'm still just trying to share on Facebook, but I will share it on Twitter as well.
Okay, thank you. I do have another computer where I was trying to share it on Twitter, but although I had been on the internet before with it, now that I moved it to a different room, it doesn't want to work.
So what were your experiences with writing this book? Like, what inspired you to do it? Or I guess we could, if you want to talk about that, I'm just curious.
In the case of In Case There's a Fox, my inspiration was just going around on my property with my daughter, who was very small at the time, and we had indications that there were foxes there. I did eventually see a fox at my daughter's school. So there are foxes in this area, but we could never see one on my property in daylight.
Mm-hmm.
And we like to paint together. I used to paint in the barn with her. And so it was kind of a painting project as well as a project of writing. This is one of the paintings. It's not the only one, but you know, this is basically how big it is. You can see how big it is relative to me. And
it's a nice size painting for sure.
Yes, and you can see it's really telling a story. It's a narrative painting. So this is the part where Sword is looking forward and the Hound Dog is looking forward. They see this rabbit, they don't see this rabbit, and they do not see the fox. Okay, so they, and then I wrote the poem, and this particular poem I wrote in English first, and then I translated it to Hebrew. But a different book that is also available for me, which is called Sword Chooses When Sword Was a Baby. I wrote the verse for that first in Hebrew, and later I translated it to English. So it can go either way.
And I think that's really neat, because I think a lot of people are interested in learning Hebrew. I know I, for one, would think it would be really neat to learn a little bit of Hebrew. So I think that's a great tool for somebody, whether they be a child or an adult, who wants to learn the Hebrew language, because it's bilingual.
Yeah. And by the way, if anybody were to comment on this live stream, I think that they would allow me to actually put the comment up on the screen.
Nice. That's exciting. Is this like a feature of StreamYard? Is that something that you're able to do?
Yeah.
That's awesome. Oh. Okay. Did not know that, but I haven't used StreamYard a lot, and I'm not sure if I can use it with my webcam anymore, because something happened where it seems that, well, with the phone, yes, but anyway, I'll let you continue.
Yeah, so I'm going to write down in case there's a fox and see if it shows up on the screen. Okay, this is
okay. I'm watching to see if it does. I'm sharing it in a couple other places as we talk, because I hope more people do discover this book. It was a very charming book, and my mom read it too, actually, and she said that she really liked it. Yeah, because I took it up there with me when I visited them. A few years back, when you hit first sent me, there's the Fox yellow shirt, which I really like that yellow shirt. I think it's a lot of fun to wear.
It looks very nice on you.
Yeah, I think it goes with my olive skin tone quite well, and my dark hair. But it's just a really cool shirt. And, I wore it out one day too, and somebody said that they really liked it. So,
well,
I almost thought maybe I should wear it tomorrow.
Okay, so now if I click to show the comment. Oh, look. Can you see it?
Oh, in case there's a fox. I love it. You can see it on the screen. That's awesome.
Yeah. So if anybody else, somebody in the audience, has a comment and it's not anything that I wouldn't want to share, I'll be happy to share it and it will show up on the screen.
Yeah, if it's pertinent to the book or what we're discussing, definitely.
Yeah. So do you know what beta readers are, Julia?
I was going to read up on that topic. I didn't have a lot of time to look into it, but can you tell us specifically what a beta reader was or is? I mean,
yeah, it's so, how there are beta testers for software that is just out.
Yeah.
Yeah, so they maybe don't pay for it and they get to use it. And then if there's a bug in the software, if there's something wrong with it, they can tell the person who's writing the software and they can fix it.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah, exactly. So, that's a great tool. That way you can find out what's wrong with it in the beginning.
Right. So beta readers are kind of like that for authors. The benefit of being a beta reader is you get to read the book. But the downside is the book may not be perfect form at the time when the beta reader receives it. There might be typos, missing pages.
Well, in advanced copies that I bring home from work, that's pretty common. Actually, I'm it's funny sometimes.
Right.
Or pages, no explanation. You're like, okay.
Yeah, so the purpose of, the way it helps the author is the author, we can't always see the errors in our work. When we write something, we don't see every flaw. And it helps to have somebody else read our work before it's published and also see what it will look like, as a book.
Mm-hmm.
And let us know if there's any improvement that could be made.
Yeah, but, I think it's a great tool, right?
Yes, it's a wonderful tool. But sometimes it's not clear to the beta readers what their function is, mm-hmm. So for instance, they're not critics. Do you know the difference? You know, can you imagine what the difference would be between?
Oh, yeah, right off, like a critic in my mind is somebody who they have a little bit more expertise in the field. Whereas a beta reader could just be like, I don't know, a mom who has some kids, and you could be an author and you offer for the mom to be a beta reader. Whereas a critic might be somebody who, well, when you look at Amazon, they have a lot of like reviews from papers and other publications and library journals saying giving reviews of books is quite different. That's more like a critic in some ways, but there's also in my mind.
Yeah, well, you know, reviewers in general can be critics, whether they're paid to write for a journal or, you know, or they could just be somebody who purchased the book and they write some criticism of the book. And of course, criticism doesn't necessarily just mean bad stuff. It can also, it can be everything. You know, this is what was good about it. Yeah. And but there's a difference between a beta reader and a critic, not in terms of necessarily getting paid to do it, but in terms of where their loyalty is supposed to go. So a critic is only loyal to the readers of his criticism. So he's got like a feeling that he's telling the public about this book, and he's very open about what he liked or didn't like about the book. But when you send a book to a beta reader, the book isn't done. It's different. And what you're saying to them is, whether you pay them or not, you know, that's not the issue. They got it for free anyway. But the issue is they should tell you what's wrong with it, but not publish what's wrong with it. Give you a chance to fix what's wrong with it.
Yeah, definitely. That's the whole point of like the advanced copies, like when they go to bookstores or libraries even, is that the publisher is giving you like a sneak preview. And you can decide if you want to buy it, but also sometimes librarians or bookstores, they will give feedback to the publisher to let them know, well, there's this, you know.
Right. Okay. But sometimes the functions of the beta reader and the critic are kind of confused in everybody's minds, because obviously if your beta reader really liked the book and, you know, he told you you have a typo on page 3 and you have this on that, but then he really liked the book and he tells you, I really enjoyed that book, you might ask him, well, if you did like it, would you like to write a review? You know, you might ask that.
You might ask them, and that would be fine.
Yeah.
You know, and you can always say in the review, and actually they encourage this with the Federal Trade Commission, you can say that it's a free, that you received a free copy, because that is something they say you should do. Personally, I don't like that stance. I don't like that that is something that they say that we should do. I don't agree with that, because I feel like we should have the freedom to decide that in my mind. But you could say that really wanted to, you know, you could do that, so it shows that yes, you liked it, but yeah, you might have a little bias because you got a free book out of it.
But here's the thing, what a beta reader should not do, which is different from a critic, is let's say he really hated the book. He really shouldn't then just go write a review about how he hated it, because his main function was, you know, just give.
Wow. Yeah, for sure. Yeah, definitely. And I don't think it's in good taste, but I've heard about this happening, not in a case of like even a children's book, I guess. I didn't know this was a thing, but apparently when some people read a novel by like a popular author that they like a really well known author, I didn't know this, but some people look them up on Facebook and friend them so they can get feature free books from them. I didn't know that you could do that. Like, it feels so, to use a British term, very cheeky to me. Like, I never thought, like, oh, I could, like, friend that author in real life on their real Facebook page and become friends with them and then actually get a book. So there was this case, and I can't bet if this is true or not, but somebody said they were mad at this author because, get this, okay, they sought this person out after they read one of their early novels. They loved it, okay? They loved that first novel, so they wanted to become friends with that person in the hopes they might get novels in the future. I don't know what their they're, but that's kind of what it sounded like. So this person actually, I guess, gave them a sneak preview, kind of like a beta reader, but they went to this person's page and they wrote kind of negative reviews about a later novel. And they were mad because the author deleted them off their Facebook page. And they were mad because they felt like, well, I was helping them out and I was writing this kind of negative review to help them and they should have kept me as a friend. And they were mad that they deleted the post and them, which I thought was interesting, but I don't know what to think about that. And I don't know if that's true, but this was just something somebody was saying on Goodreads.
Yeah. Well, some people think that they're doing you a really big favor by writing really bad review of your novel or
story. Can I say why? There's nothing wrong with being blunt. I get it. That being honest is good. Being blunt is good. But sometimes there's a line, okay? Like, this is just my thought. There is a line where some things are just not a good taste and some things are not helpful, okay? Like, for instance, let's say you were invited to someone's house, like for a party, and they served food that you didn't like, and you just were blunt about it and said the food was nasty. I mean, would those people want to invite you again to their house? Like, would they want to?
No.
Okay, to me, it just lacks a bit of good taste. Like, you don't have to be Miss Prim and Proper. You can be honest about things, but I think if you were given a book for free to help out, give some feedback to the author, it's kind of in poor taste to just write a really trashy review because you think it's helping them out. You're not really helping anybody.
Well, yeah. See, here's the thing. The beta reader, you know, by giving constructive criticism, can be quite blunt, but not in a public way because...
No, not in a public way. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, because... this is an opportunity for the author to maybe go back and fix some things. That's why he's a beta reader.
Plus, here's another thing too. This is just my thought. You can destroy relationships, whether it be like a friendship, like any kind of relationship with somebody. Like, it's one thing to be blunt, to just give somebody feedback. But when you get to the point that you're like, well, the way I see things is right, and you're just like kind of sticking it to someone and it's not helpful. I don't know what you're going to achieve because most people, like with the dinner party analogy, if you went to someone's house and you just trashed what they made for dinner and complained about, I don't know, everything, but you thought you were being helpful, I don't think that they'd want to be friends with you anymore. Kind of the same with a beta reader. Somebody did that. Like, I don't think most people would want to be their friend. Like in the example, the guy that was mad he got deleted because he went to that person's page and wrote a negative review about a book he got for free when he could have just helped that person and sent a message privately. Like, why would he do that?
It's right.
It's kind of awkward too.
Right. So what you need to understand about authors is they're people like everybody else. They can take criticism. It is okay to tell them what you think didn't work or what is not good. You know, there's a difference between a proofreader and a beta reader too. So a proofreader is actually looking for typos and that's all they care about.
Yeah, typos, but maybe not context, you know.
Right.
Like a grammarly person, like the grammarian, so to speak.
Yes, but a beta reader is an actual reader who likes to read that particular genre of book and so would have constructive criticism on the structure of the book and the story and the characterization. And if it's in rhyme, like In Case There's a Box is actually a poem. If there's an error in the poetry and the meter, the beta reader could tell you about that. But he shouldn't write a review saying, oh, there's an error in the meter here, because you're going to fix it. Once you find out if it's really true, there's an error there, you're going to try to fix it. So it's not even going to be there in the final product.
You definitely could. You know, there was another example of this where there was a lady, she wrote a children's book, okay? Similar to how you did. And I thought, it seemed like a perfectly fine children's book. It might not have been my favorite in the world, but it was about flowers. But she gave it to this lady to review, like be nice, because she thought, well, this lady has a background in books. And the lady said that She didn't think it was good for children. And she, like, was kind of harsh. And this wasn't public, but it was kind of, it got kind of nasty. Like, she said, the illustrations are scary. And I don't think they were. They kind of reminded me of something like Dia Muerte. It just wasn't happy in a cheerful children's book. But I thought for an older group of kids, it might have been okay. And the grammar wasn't, it was a little off, but I don't know. Like, she could have just, like made some examples, but she tore the book apart. And the lady was kind of depressed about it. She goes, oh, how am I going to tell my friend that this person said all this? I said, I don't know. I suggested to her, maybe you could get a second opinion. But she looked kind of depressed because I don't know if all that was helpful. Because basically she was just saying that she didn't think this book should be published, period.
Right. Yeah.
That's not helpful, you know.
Exactly. So, you know, In Case There's a Box was one of the first books that I tried to self-publish, even before Inverted A Press came out. And the first version looked like this. I don't know if you saw it. So it has like a verse here.
I didn't have that version. I had the bilingual one that you sent me.
Right. Yes. So it like had a verse, when Sword goes for walks in the fields full of flocks, she is always concerned that she might meet a fox. And then you turn the page and there was part of that painting. Well, not this one, but the other painting. Okay. And then there's another verse. So when Sword makes her rounds, inspecting the grounds, then along for the stroll comes her trusty bloodhound. And that, you know, this is actually a proof, but there should be a picture of the bloodhound. Anyway, some people liked it that way. And other people thought it wasn't good that the pictures were separate from the words. Mm-hmm. What do you think about that?
I mean, either way, it doesn't really bother me. I do like the new version where for visually stimulated people that the words are with the pictures, because it seems like a lot of people like books that way nowadays. But to be honest with you, I like books that might have more text and words, pictures on other pages. So for me, like, the first version works too, but I think that the newer version might work for a lot of people that want a very visually stimulating book. So, but that's kind of
right.
But I like both versions, to be honest. Like, I don't know either one.
Yeah, the bilingual one opens up on both sides. It's got the Hebrew version, the Mikosh Shual, and my name in Hebrew. And it has the English on the front part, in case there's a fox, I a cat's in English. And so it meets in the middle. And at this point, I learned as a publisher how to let the, this is called full bleed, because the colors go all the way to the edge of the paper.
That's what I'm saying, like, is very visually stimulating. I think people like that.
Yeah. So, I thought it was technically an improvement over the previous one, not just because it's both in Hebrew and in English, but also because of the full bleed illustrations. But then somebody who really liked the first book told me, you know, the first publication, oh, no, I like it this way. I don't really like those others. So, you know, you can buy it either version.
Yeah, you can buy either version. I think that's the great thing about having multiple versions of a children's book. Now, this is one thing I would really like that if Amazon could do is through their Kindle program, like, make it a hardbound version. Like, I wish they offered that. I think that would be really awesome.
Yes, because a lot of children's books just they seem better, you know.
But if they're soft cover too. I mean, I do see a lot of soft cover books because I clean a lot of books with Virex every day of my life. So I see a lot of soft, but there are more hardbound to softbound. But there are quite a few, like a lot of the Clifford books, a lot of the major children's books, Henry and Mudge. I mean, there are soft cover versions of them. I just really wish I could buy a hard cover version through Amazon. That's just something that I would like to see them offer in the near future. Just my opinion on Amazon, anyway.
Right. So I write children's books and books for adults, too. And I don't want to confuse people about the different ones. So Ping and the Snarkly People, for instance, is a chapter book for children.
Yeah, it was fun.
Yeah, and I did not illustrate that one. That one had a cover by Lainey Frick. Let's see. What other children's books of mine do you think you may have read?
I read Ping and the Snarkly People, and I have read In Case There's a Fox children's books. Oh, and When Beau Met Sword, of course.
When Sword Met Beau. Okay.
Yeah.
And
that's cute too. And
yeah.
You did read Band from Lunch to Me, although that's not published in a new format on your.
Yeah, I might ask you to be a beta reader for me.
I'd love to do that. And you know what? Maybe I can get some other people to. I don't know. I feel like I don't have. But I would throw it out there that a lot of people right now, their kids are, not everybody's going to be sending their kids back to regular format school. So I think right now, this would be a great opportunity to have parents be beta readers or maybe teachers.
Yeah. Yeah. That would be a very fine thing. Another book that I published was Sword Chooses. It's a picture book for babies.
Yes, I do remember that one. That was cool, yeah.
And Kelly Clear read that one.
Oh, he remember? Did a very good job, yeah.
Yeah. So a lot of my books are available on Audible.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. Do you think we should screen share any of that so that people can see what books are available on Audible and which ones are available on Amazon?
I guess I could try to do that, but I am on my phone.
Oh, okay. Let me try then. I'll try to
fix the problem with my webcam. I don't know what's going on with that.
Yeah. Okay. I'm just going to go Audible, iCat. Okay, well, they're showing me the Amazon books that are on Audible rather than showing me my Audible books, but let's see. Okay, I think I have it. Let's see how we do the screen share on here because it's kind of different, right?
It is a little bit different, and I know there's a way to do it, but when I'm on my phone, it's just a little bit of a smaller screen. It might be under the cam mic option. You know, this is the thing. Maybe I can try and join the live stream as a second person. I don't know. See if I can.
I don't know. I don't know. I'm trying to screen share. Okay. I'm sharing. And. Am I sharing yet?
I'm looking at the screen and I still just see us. But I see the wonderful thing In Case There's a Fox, so everybody knows what we're talking about.
Okay. Trying again.
So we have, oh, here we go. It's coming. It's just, here it is. Okay. I see it. It's, you see all the books.
Yeah, so this is my Audible profile. It shows a picture of me and Beau. And it says I'm a linguist, primatologist, publisher, and writer, not necessarily in that order. I'm also the mother of two teenagers. Well, you know what? Sword's not a teenager anymore. I guess I have to revise that. Yeah, Beau is 18, but Sword is about to turn 21. Can you believe it?
I can't believe it. So is Brian. You know, Sword and Brian, my nephew, they're the same age.
Oh, yeah, right.
That's really awesome.
Okay, so I'm just going to forget about the biography, which is updated, and go to my Audible books. Well, not all of them are for children. So Vacuum County, which is narrated by Kelly Clear, is not. Yeah. Not for children, though, right?
Not for children. I just like anything with Kelly Clear. I'm like, can we have him on again? I just wish he'd come back on.
I would like him to, but he's so busy officiating for his church now that they're doing everything on, you know, online instead of going to church. So I don't know what's going
on. But I'll say, Kelly, if you're watching right now, we miss you. We want you to come back on.
Okay, so then there's Sword Chooses. That's definitely for children. It is narrated by Kelly Clear. Can you see that?
I do see it.
Okay, good. And then there is Ping and the Snarkly People. And that one is narrated by Evelyn Adams. And we had her on, didn't we?
Yeah, she was quite an articulate and well-spoken lady. I thought that was very interesting speaking to her.
Yes, and she's a very good narrator, too. Did you get a chance to hear her?
I did, because she read a segment on the set live stream.
Yeah. Okay, good. And then there is When Sword Met Bow, and that is narrated by Kelly Clear. And then there is In Case There's a Fox, and that one is narrated by Patrick Kahn, but this is not the bilingual one.
How did you find Patrick Kahn? That's an interesting story, I think.
Well, I just put up that I was looking for a narrator on Audible. I didn't know anybody who wanted to narrate. And Patrick Kahn and several other people tried out. And he has such a great voice. Can I read you? I mean, can I play the sample for you?
Oh, yes. I love listening to Patrick Kahn. Very spoony.
Did you?
I also think, I know Aya says she's taking a break from writing for a while, but I kind of hope she'll write something about bow and pickle ice or bananas. Like, I kind of thought about that too. Like, another story about bow as a teenager, if she ever does decide to take up the writing mantle again.
Okay. Were you able to hear that? Because you were talking.
I didn't hear anything. I heard you like, I didn't hear anything coming up. I thought you were trying to find it.
No. So I guess it doesn't work with screen share, I guess.
Really? Oh.
Okay. How do I stop screen sharing? That's the question.
I don't want. There's a button up that says stop. There should be.
Because I don't want to end the broadcast, which is another process.
I think you put on the screen thing, the screen
share. Oh,
button.
Okay.
That should bring us.
All
back.
Right.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. So he has. Sorry.
I said I want to try and figure out what's going on wrong with my webcam because, to be honest with you, ever since the pandemic started, I've been kind of frustrated we can't use Zoom anymore, and then with StreamYard, it seems like everything's a little wonky. A little bit.
Yeah, it is a little bit different, and sometimes the audio is not that good.
Yeah, I've noticed that too. But also too, another thing is, I think, okay, it's great that people can use Zoom, but it seems like now everybody's just using Zoom to socialize, which I thought was interesting. And it's used to be for live streaming and things like that.
Yes, they are using it to socialize, to have meetings with family and colleagues, but that's just how it is. So anyway, do you have any more questions about how to publish a children's book?
Well, one thing I guess I would like to know is, okay, how do you come up, like, I love the yellow. I think the yellow was very striking with the illustrations. What made you come up with that color for the cover, since you had to design your own cover? Like, what inspired you to find the complementary colors?
Well, I wanted a color that would look nice with this part of the painting, because I believe that this painting of the sword and the fox is the best part of the painting. So I didn't, you know, I didn't include the entire painting in this case. And I wanted to write in case there's a fox and I a cat. And I wanted to have the Hebrew title also here. So what I found was that the yellow stands out best over here in the painting, the part of the painting that I'm sharing here. So then I thought, well, if we do it in this sort of negative way where it takes away from the painting over here, we could have the yellow be the background to the black lettering.
That's a great use of negative space. I think you did a really good job in making a striking cover. So I just wanted to hear the story behind it, but that's really cool.
Yeah.
Another thing I have is, like, let's say if somebody did want to go and write a children's book like you did. I don't think they could do it through Creative Space anymore. They have to do it through Kindle now. Is that correct?
Yes, they have to do it through Kindle, and they have to learn how to typeset the book under a different set of rules.
Okay. So I guess that would be interesting. I did think Creative Space was kind of interesting, although I never played around with it. So basically all the Creative Space books migrated over to the Kindle format. Is that correct?
Yes. It's used to be called Create Space, not Creative Space, but
yeah, okay.
Create Space. And they had patterns that you could use to typeset your book, and they gave you rules about it. But now they say they're going to take it from your Kindle version. Well, my Kindle version was never as well typeset as my, you know, my paperbacks.
Yeah, definitely. I understand that. I mean, it's unfortunate that Create Space is no longer there then, because it seems like you'd have to learn a new format. But I suppose it's possible. It just seems like a lot of extra.
Yeah. That's the thing about, you know, progress, so to speak. It's all very well and good to have a new way to do something, but when you throw out the old way, that means that a lot of people who have a lot of experience, their experience just went down the drain.
Well, they always say you shouldn't throw away the wheel. I mean, shouldn't.
Yeah.
They do all the time. I mean.
Yeah, absolutely they do. And, you know, I have some experience with elderly people trying to learn new things like an iPhone. And if the iPhone started out being more like a traditional phone, where, you know, for instance, you open your iPhone and it's got a black, you know, it's got a black screen, but a lot of times you open it and there are a bunch of icons on it. Well, that doesn't look like a phone to somebody who might have been using a phone all her life. And so she would ask, I'm sorry, but where are the numbers? How do I dial? If it's a phone, how do I dial? So why don't they just have the keypad for the dialing? Why don't they make that come up first?
It should. I mean, that would make more sense. The only thing I can kind of recommend, most people, they want like the nice, smarter phones. But there is a phone for people that are older. Like, that's a basic cell phone called the Jitterbug phone. And it's just a very basic phone that I believe has more user-friendly features. But it doesn't do all the cool things that an iPhone would do.
Well, you know, I think if you wanted to teach all the cool things, it would still be nice if it started with the traditional things and then you could move to the cool things. You know what I'm saying?
No, I agree with you. I definitely agree with you. But maybe somebody needs to think about that when they design these phones. Like, be more user-friendly, but do they do that? No.
Right. You can spend a lifetime learning how to do something and the next day they'll change how you do it. And that lifetime just goes down the drain. And if you're young, you can learn the new way. But the older you get, the harder it is to learn new tricks, you know?
Well, the funny thing is, though, a lot of younger people decide, oh, I like those things that they used to do like 25, 30 years ago. Like they said, oh, you should get rid of all your records and get CDs. And then when the iPod first became a thing, they're like, yeah, you don't need any CDs more. You should just have an iPod. But then a few years ago, I started to see young people walk around with boom boxes with sound coming out because they grew up with the little headphones. And they were like, oh my gosh, there's this thing that actually plays like really good quality sounding music. Because my dad's kind of a snob about music. He bought these amazing speakers in Thailand. He's like, they have the best speakers in Thailand. I don't know. He was just very, they are really good speakers, okay? Like, they're very good quality. But they never went out of style. But now they think, oh, like this little, so maybe not all old things are bad. Like records, some people say records sound better than the digital copy of a song. I've had people tell me that.
Right. Yeah. And then there's the issue of should you, like if you're illustrating children's books, should you use photographs or should you use drawings, black and white drawings or paintings in many colors? What do you think about that?
I think it depends on the context, the mood you want to convey with the children's book, and whether you just want to use photographs or you want to maybe do an ink drawing. Or like, okay, I think a lot of people love the full color bleed illustration type children's books, but they didn't always used to be that way. Like one of my favorite books when I was a kid was called Katie and the Snow Plow. It had a few little illustrations in the corner of each page that I think the colors were like blue, red. They were very basic illustrations. They weren't all full bleed paint. You know, they were more like that first version of the case or there's a fox, which you showed me. So I don't know. It depends on the story, I believe, or the author. But the only thing is, I think modern young readers might not be adept to just a photograph children's book, unless it's the. I guess I would leave that up to the readers to decide.
Well, let me show you one of my favorite children's books from when I was a child. Of course, it's in Hebrew and it's from Israel and it's falling apart. But just look at it for the illustration. Wow. Can you see the illustration?
Yes, it is. That's neat.
Yeah, so really it's only in two colors. I mean, the writing is in red, but the illustration is in white in a kind of a yellow space, you know, a yellow background. And this is called Ani v'Tali Sefer Me'eretz HaLama. So it's Tali and I. Tali is this little girl. And this guy is Abraham Shlonsky, the author. So it's about him and this little girl. And they're riding a horse or something like that. But if you look inside the book, there are lots of illustrations, but they're basically inky kind of pictures, which are black on white. I don't know if you can see any of that.
That's actually how children used to be, though. A lot of them used to be like that.
Right. And, you know, if I were to make an illustration that looks like that, people would say she can't draw. But I know this person who illustrated this could draw. The guy who drew it says, Ciel Yechezkel Kamli.
Well, look at the horse on the cover. Of course he can draw. It's a very well-drawn horse. So if somebody says
right,
that,
yeah, but you see how it's kind of sloppy on purpose? You know what I'm saying?
To appeal to children. I mean, it's for children. It's yeah.
Right, so... Yeah,
a little bit of a double standard in that because I think some of the modern children's books have very childish drawings, but it's just because it's full color bleed page, people accept it more readily.
Yeah, I'm looking at the illustrator's name printed rather than in handwriting. So it's Yechezkel Kimchi. That's the guy's name. But anyway, if you're not really allowed to draw in such a primitive way anymore, it seems like, if you're going to do children's illustrations in the United States right now, don't you think?
Yes, to some degree, but I think what it is some of the drawings are primitive, but they just use a lot of color. Because have you seen Pete the Cat? He looks pretty childish to me, like the way he's drawn. But I think they get away with it because it's like full of color. And like it's kind of like they're able to cheat or something. Because it's not really, but it's not really quickly drawn like these drawings, if that makes any sense. It's quick, but it's just colorful.
Right. I want to share with you some another unpublished children's book of mine, but I have to go and get it. So if you would talk to people and make sure that they are entertained while I go get that, okay? Yeah.
So anyway, I guess I'll just talk a little bit about children's books that I read when I was a kid. I would say, like, there were illustrations, but I would say even in the 70s and 80s, they weren't always a full blade. Well, I wasn't reading in the 70s. I was a baby. But in the 80s, when I was in school, like, the books, like, with the illustrations in the books, they weren't always, like, a full-blade, colorful page. Like, it would sometimes be more simplistic. Like, I was talking about that book, Katie and the Snowplow, which really spoke to my heart because I grew up in the mountains, and we had snowplows that would move the snow off the roads. And the illustrations in that book were just a few colors, and they didn't always take up the whole page. Like, they were on the corner of the page or maybe half of the page. So I think there's been just a change to more visually stimulating illustrations. But sometimes it seems like it's more colorful, if that makes any sense. I don't know. If that's just like a marketing thing, they're afraid to have too simplistic. But maybe we need to go back to that. Maybe this Israeli children's book might be innovative, because maybe people would be interested, Aya, because it would deviate from what they're doing now, and sometimes change or retro throwbacks are something exciting.
Yeah, I mean, if we had a major publisher do that, I think it would take off like, you know, lightning. But when you are a small publisher, you have to be very careful, because every little thing you do, they might think is a mistake, even if it's not a mistake.
That's true. But it's not fair, like, in a way. It's interesting.
Yeah, but you are judged by your press a lot of times.
Oh, you definitely are. This is so true.
So I'm going to write down the title of the book that I'm going to tell you about now.
Okay. Sounds cool.
You may have heard it. Okay, so it's a long title. I am writing it. And then I'm going to see if I can share it.
Okay.
Can you see it?
I'm looking now. Oh, The Little Boy Who Didn't Catch a Fish.
Yes. So this was, you know, this is just my working thing. So if I allow you to be my beta reader for it, I might send you this kind of spiral back version of it. Or
yeah, I would like to do that. I'm excited.
Yeah. So look at this picture. It's obviously not, it's kind of primitive. It's not very, it was probably done in pencil.
It's kind of cool, though. I like when you see it up close, because you can kind of see, like, the pencil shading.
Okay, so you can see that. It's basically
a fish, too. The fish is pretty cool.
Yeah. Yeah, and there's also some bait here. You see the bait?
I do now. Yes, I do now.
Okay. All right, so that's what I thought the cover should look like. But on the first page, I had a picture of the family of the little boy. And again, it was basically a pencil sketch of the family, the mother, the mother, the father, the little boy, and his sister, who was giving him horns there. Can you see that?
Isn't this the one that you turned into a painting a little bit more?
Yeah, so I wanted to show you this, and then I wanted to show you the painting and have you tell me which one you like better. Okay, so this is the original sketch.
Well, I can say that I do like pencil sketches and portraits of people. This is fun. You know what's kind of fun about this one is it kind of has more of a retro, like, 70s feel to it, which I kind of like the hairdos. Like, it just looks like something from the mid-70s, which I think is kind of awesome.
Yeah.
Really cool. This just feels a bit more modern to me for some reason, like circa 2005. Like, I don't know why, but it just has more of a modern feel to it. He kind of reminds me of Arnold Schwarzenegger. That's so off, but I don't know why.
I know. Every once in a while when I draw somebody and I don't intend them to look like Arnold Schwarzenegger, they do look like that.
But I love the lady. Like, she just looks very, like, long hair, very, like, she looks like a suburban housewife. Like, hi, honey. And just very, she's cool, too. Kids are fun.
Yeah. So, I was thinking maybe of making this the cover instead of the picture of the fish. What do you think?
I think that would be fun. Yeah, why not? I think you should. You could do both. You could also do both versions, maybe. I don't know.
All right, but let's be realistic. When you are a small press, do you think it confuses the readers if there are two versions?
Probably. I think, okay, this is my take on it. There would be original art for the book before it became a book, before it became a novel, like Memoirs of a Geisha, which is not a children's book, but this is just an example. They had a picture of some random geisha. But then when it became a movie, all of a sudden they had a photograph from the movie. Same with, like, I don't know, like a famous children's book that's turned into a movie. Oh, all of a sudden an illustration or like some CGI image from a movie. Is the cover.
And even the Secret River, I don't know if you saw, I did a reading of the Secret River or part of it on my YouTube channel a while back when Bo was smaller. Yeah, and it had beautiful illustrations. It's not my book, it's just a book I was reading.
Yes,
and the illustrations, I loved them, but they were like three colors, like brown, black, and white. That's all they were, but they were beautiful.
What I was talking about from the illustrations from children's books in the 80s and 70s, a lot of them were just a few colors. They weren't like these bold in your face colors.
Right. And then they redid that book, and it came out with much more, in some ways, I guess you would say, more professional illustrations, prettier illustrations. But there was something magical about the older ones, I thought.
I agree. I feel like, okay, look, I love colorful illustrations. I love beautiful illustrations. But I feel like there's something nostalgic and creative, like, to the mind about some of these books with the more simplistic illustrations, because it kind of allows the child to conjure imagery of the story on their own. Whereas when you have this book with just like the sensory overload image, which can be very beautiful, but it kind of tells the child what they should be seeing. Whereas with the more simplistic image, when I was a child, it allowed me to visualize what I thought the characters would look like and be doing a bit more, and I kind of like that.
Yeah. So I don't know, you know, this might be too much information. There's
I think I like the family because it's a very more colorful painting than the original, but it's not overwhelming and it's subdued. So I think it's a nice, it gives you an idea that there's a family and there's a little boy. And the little girl's putting bunny ears behind them, right?
Yes, exactly.
So it kind of sets you up to see that it's a story about a little boy who might be kind of mocked in some way by his sister. And it kind of sets up the story a little bit. I kind of like it.
Okay, but does it bother you that the title of the book isn't The Boy Who Was Mocked by His Sister, it's The Little Boy Who Didn't Catch a Fish? Is that still okay for this picture?
I think it's okay with me. I totally get it. Like, to me, that's fine. Unless you feel like it has to have a fish. I guess you could ask a few other people, but I'm okay with it. Like, to me, it resonates.
Okay.
I read a lot of books, so I think I know something or two. I see a lot of books every day. I really think I know about
Yes, I think you are professional when it comes to evaluating books.
Yes, 100%. When it comes to cover art and books, I think I have a good eye for it. This is the difference between a professional press, not a professional, but a well-backed one, and a smaller press, is that they just have more exposure. And that's about it.
Yeah. So, yeah, the two children's books that I'm thinking of putting out but have not yet put out are The Little Boy Who Didn't Catch a Fish, and the other one is Banned from Lunch.
I'm really excited about Banned from Lunch because it's so relevant right now. It talks about, I think, for people of all ages, for children, it really covers something that I think would be good to know. You know, just from a different perspective.
Yeah, I know. So what it covers is kind of a sensitive topic, which is bias and discrimination. But do you think it's appropriate to have a book like that for children?
Yes, I do, because right now we have people telling children like how they should view this, and it's a very, it's very partisan driven. I'm gonna say one side, the other side. There is no like rational voices in the room, so to speak, like, and I feel like we need some rational voices that say, hey, there is a problem with many different types of discrimination. It's not just one kind, it's many different kinds, and it can happen to anybody, and it, and we should talk about it. We shouldn't just say only, you know, but that's my take on it, and I think a lot of people agree with us from what I've been seeing. A lot of people do agree with us. We might not all agree on it. Aspect of it, but I think if you look, there are more people that are saying there is a narrative problem in this country right now. There is a social movement problem right now where one group of people think that they're right and the others are wrong, but that's not entirely the truth.
Yeah, there's, when people are discriminated against or stopped by the police, it could be for all sorts of different reasons.
All sorts of different reasons. Can we be honest? Everybody has been stopped. Everybody that's had an interaction, even if they're on the better side, it might not always be the best one.
Yeah, but I'm surprised by some of my neighbors who are sure if somebody was stopped, it was because they did something wrong. How do you explain that?
How do I explain that? Because they're part of that small town and they're not going to stop them because they know them, so they have a bias. Whereas if
somebody... it's not quite that clear to me, because
I think so.
We're talking about a place where there is no local police force. And they're sending the highway patrol to patrol this tiny little town. So I don't think they all know each other at all. But there are some people who never get stopped. Why not?
They're not being profiled. Maybe they look a certain way. Or they're not alone. They're not alone. If you're alone, like, okay, if you're alone by yourself as a woman, just experiences from my family, where my mom said she knew she wasn't speeding because my mom's a very careful driver and she's always looking at the speedometer. But a highway patrolman told her back in the late 70s that she was definitely speeding on this road going down the mountain. And she said, no, I'm not. And she was able to like talk to him about it rationally. And he's like, yeah, you're right. Actually, we'll just be safe. Okay, have a nice day. And he left. But somebody else on that same road a few days later questioned herself. She was driving alone as a woman. And when the man stopped her again, it was probably the same highway patrolman, we believe. She was like, oh my gosh, maybe I was speeding. Okay, I have to take the ticket. Because she didn't know what to do and she felt intimidated. So it came out that this was kind of a trend where women, I didn't really hear this with men, but women that were driving alone seemed to be pulled over by the highway patrol and be told that they went over the line, they were speeding, even if these things didn't happen. That's what I've been hearing anyway. And even more.
Yeah.
More recently, this is another gross thing. People from all different backgrounds, some of them are white, some of them are Hispanic, some of them are black, they were being pulled over by policemen and highway patrolmen of different agencies around the same time period a couple years ago, being told that they were looking at their cell phone. Some of them were and some of them weren't. Sometimes you could just have your cell phone on the dashboard and there would be a highway patrolman sitting at the 7-Eleven, and he would be pulling people over. And because he saw it visibly on the dashboard, he would say, "You were texting. You're not supposed to. You're supposed to do hands-free driving." And you could say, "Well, no, I wasn't." But he could say, "Well, it was visible on the dashboard, and I'm going to give you a ticket." And then other people would talk to them and talk them out of it. So there's a lot of things. And this was a diverse group of people, okay? It wasn't just one ethnicity. It seemed to be women that were alone. That's what I've heard, anyway.
Okay, yeah. The other thing is that they do profile people for driving slower than their permitted speed. I don't know if you know that, but...
That's interesting.
They suspect them of being under the influence, of driving under the influence. And so if you are a super cautious driver, you are more likely to be stopped because they think you're going to be drunk.
That's ridiculous. What if you're just being cautious? Like,
yeah. Yeah. So sometimes I think that when someone snaps back, "Well, I'm sorry you were caught, but if you had just been not driving fast, you wouldn't have been caught." Maybe it goes to their own assumption, because they do drive the speed limit or beyond and never get stopped. And so they figured someone must have done something really bad to be stopped.
That could be the case, but here's another example. Let's say you're just walking at night because you like to walk, or you're walking to work and you don't drive. Like, sometimes women are stopped. What are you doing? Like, why are you out at night?
Like, yeah.
I don't think that's right. Why are, like, if it was a man, they'd probably be like, "Oh, are you up to some mischief?" But if you're a woman, what are you doing out at night? As if you don't have the right to decide you want to go for a walk. But I actually have heard a case of men, and I'm going to take that back, because I was reading on this forum. There was this man, and he actually said he was Caucasian, and he said he liked to go walking at night after the Jay Leno. This was many, many years ago, just as an example, because he said after Jay Leno did his monologue or whatever it was, he liked to go for a midnight walk. And he said the police stopped him a few times and said, "Are you, like, doing graffiti on the walls and stuff?" And he just liked to walk at night. So I don't understand why you have to, like, defend yourself as to when you like to walk. That's kind of ridiculous.
Yeah. No, we have the right to do that. We have the right to assemble. We have the right to drive in a car or go around without a mask. We have all those rights.
We do. And here's another thing, too. And it kind of harkens back to people saying, "Well, I'm sorry you got stopped, but I didn't get stopped." And it's no criticism of that person. But this is why a lot of people, they're just not going to go on social media and tell you, "Hey, I'm not going to wear a mask," because a lot of people would post righteously on social media, even though it came out recently that, well, the mask might not protect you. And I'm afraid to say that around people who really believe in the mask, because you'll kind of get bullied for it if you don't say, "Oh, yes, 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 the mask will definitely protect you." But I noticed there was a major publication that actually revealed that information recently. But then they had to retract it and say it wasn't completely true. Really? Are you kidding me? So now, like, you know what it was? It's because it went against the narrative of the shutdown. And nobody wants to say that. But here's the thing, Aya. It doesn't matter if you go to the beach, to a protest, or anywhere. You still can get the coronavirus. If you're assembling in a group of people. Just, that's an example.
You still can No, I'm in a group of people. I told you about it, and I keep a pretty low profile there, just because I joined the group to find out about the coronavirus. I was worried about it.
Yeah, I was too, but not as much. I'm not saying it's not a problem, but go ahead. I'm sorry.
Well, now the lady that runs the group was explaining that, yes, you could get the coronavirus at a protest, but people have you have to balance people's emotional well-being with their health. And she only says that for BLM protests.
For one group of people. Well, here's the thing, Aya. 3 weeks ago, there was a peaceful protest here in our city. because some business owners wanted to open up their businesses. They weren't being hateful. They weren't being mean. Some of them weren't wearing a mask, and people were upset about that. So it was a problem with that particular group of people that weren't political, by the way. They were not political. They just wanted to reopen their businesses. I don't know. Some of them were tattoo artists. Like, those are pretty out there type of people. These aren't exactly like the high society tea drinking, very conservative people. They didn't even really have a political agenda. They just wanted to get back to work because a lot of people are suffering. And there's also an article about Lebanon that I kind of want to segue into. I hope I'm not taking it
too okay. Long. Yeah, no, that's fine. I'm just going to change our topic here. So when people come in, they'll know what we're talking about.
Okay.
So I am writing Lebanon.
Into this. It's like insular American obsession. This is my thought. You might not agree with me, but this is my take on it. Americans are a very insular bunch of people, in my opinion. I think we should care about what's happening in our country, but I think we're very righteous. And Americans, every single American who has an internet connection, a home, is a little darn privileged tonight, because I don't know if you read the news, like I'm jumping topics again, with what's happening in Lebanon, but people in Lebanon might not be able to afford bread or electricity with a lot of things their government's doing with their currency. So maybe our problems here aren't as big as problems in some other countries. I'm just saying.
What is their government doing with their currency? Can you tell me, Julia?
From what I read the article, I could just read it and share.
Okay.
I'm not an economics expert, but it sounds like they're playing around with the currency. And this is another problem in Lebanon. I'm not sure if I believe in bailouts, but basically when they did the coronavirus shutdown, there was no type of stimulus. But here's the problem. When you tell people they can't work and then they can't work for a few weeks and they finally come back and there's no type of stimulus, they're going to suffer a little bit more than countries where there was. And I'm not saying that stimulus is right or wrong, because I think we're going to have a problem too, because the stimulus is creating this false sense of security right now, to be honest with you. But
yeah.
Anyway, people can read the article on the BBC about what's going on in Lebanon at the moment. I don't want to misspeak, but I want to tell you this. They're having protests too, and it's not a racial thing. Actually, Lebanon people have this very outdated view of Lebanon. They're like, scary. Lebanon is so scary because of the Civil War, but they don't know that that was 30 years ago. Like, how can people not know that was 30 years ago? And here's another thing. A lot of people went on to Lebanon on vacation up until recently. It was actually safe to go there. Well, maybe not every part, but it's actually became a very stable country until they started having the problems with their currency last year. And that seemed to be a government problem. So people were protesting in the streets. But what I'll tell you is this, is they're having some violent protests. Well, it's not even protests. It's just turning into rioting as well. And it's not over race, but the same things are happening in Lebanon. So I find that interesting. I just wanted to share that.
Yeah, I appreciate that. What does Nassim Taleb say about this? Did he say anything about it on Twitter lately?
I haven't got a chance to listen to anything that Nassim Taleb said about it. I mean, I guess we could go look at his feed right now. He probably is talking about it. I just wanted to share.
Yeah.
That there's countries having bigger problems in the U.S. and I think we're a little insular and obsessed with ourselves, and I don't like it. I hate it, to be honest with you. I'm so tired of it.
Yeah.
But that's my interpretation. You don't have to agree with me. That's my reaction to what's going on in our country right now.
Oh, this is so weird. I'm on his website right now.
Yeah.
And he posted a book review of The Count of Monte Cristo.
Huh.
He did this on June 8th, 2020. Isn't that odd?
That is very odd. There must be some correlation between what's happening in Lebanon and that novel by Alexandre Dumas. What do you think the connection is?
I have no idea. So I don't know. He's linking to it on Amazon. So he wrote an Amazon review. Isn't that funny?
That is funny. Well, maybe Nassim Taleb should review one of your books. Like, hello, Nassim.
Oh, I would love for him to review my book. But I think
that would be interesting. I'd like to see what he would say about it. Because I think he's kind of a rational person. The thing I like about Nassim Taleb is that he advocates for local control of communities, whether it be in the U.S. or Lebanon. And I think that's a great idea.
Yes, I agree. I want to share that review right now, but it still seems to remember the previous screen share that I did. I'm trying to figure out how to screen share a different screen. You know what I'm saying?
I know exactly what you're saying. I would try and help, but I'm on my phone. I just want to bring up Lebanon, because can we just talk about some, like, to me, I like to talk about other places, what's happening in the world. I don't want to just talk about U.S. issues all the time. That's the
right
problem. U.S. is insular. Everybody in the U.S. has privilege. You know why? Because we're not going to starve to death like the people in Lebanon. And one of the things that they mentioned in that article is that they are unable to enforce social distancing in Lebanon. They don't have that luxury, buddies. And guess what? They said, the thing that I pointed out 3 months ago, is that more people could die of starvation in Lebanon than the coronavirus. That is the only thing that's going to happen in Lebanon. Do you care, people that are so up in your own minds, Americans? Probably not, because it's not your country. You don't care. But just stop acting like we're the only ones, because I think there's some problems economically worldwide. Just my take on it, you know?
So, Julia, can you see the review on the screen?
I do see the review on the screen. See if I can make it bigger on my computer to try and read it. It says the treasure will prevent you from enjoying other novels. Oh, I grew up under the cultural bias that Alexandre Dumas was middle brows. Interesting. What do you think of that?
Well,
this interview is good. This is good, right?
Yeah.
I want to bring it up on Amazon so I can read it, maybe. I don't know. Let me see. Because I have a hard time seeing it on the screen.
Okay, let me read it to you.
Okay, go ahead.
So I grew up under the cultural bias that Dumas was for middle brows, not literary. Hence, one should quickly read The Three Musketeers when still in puberty, followed by Dickens, then move on to real and literary novelists like Flaubert, Zola, or perhaps Balzac, as a preparation for someday the Russians. Dumas' reputation was not helped by a posthumous smear campaign that spread the rumor that Dumas used an entire workshop, atelier, of ghostwriters, no doubt fed with the French wordplay around a racial connotation. Ghostwriter has a double meaning in French. So it was the most pleasant surprise that during the lockdown of COVID-19, I accidentally got into this. Owing to the early developments around the pandemic, I could not easily concentrate on the usual material. So looking for a historical novel, I opened the book and could not stop. In spite of its length, it is built like a short theater play. There is not a single detail at any point that doesn't later on come to count in the resolution. And you know it instinctively, so you do not miss anything. It moves very fast, but is 1,600 pages long. I read the French version. I cannot vouch. Yes. And then he says, I cannot vouch for this translation. As I said, I read in the original, but I have not read a more absorbing novel written in the past 180 years. Read old books. Okay.
Oh,
well,
you know what? I love Nassim Taleb for saying that. Thank you, Nassim. That's great.
Yeah, I love that too. And notice that he didn't go out his way to write a bad review of anybody. He wrote a very good review and he gave it 5 stars.
Yeah. And you know what I like that he said? He said, you know what? Like, oh, this is considered middle brow, but maybe there's something more to it. Like, then, like, that's a good point.
Yeah, so That was the Count of Monte Cristo, right?
Yes. I was wondering if it was going to have like some sort of parallel to what's happening in Lebanon, but I suppose not. But I do think we should continue to watch his page to see what he's posting about what's happening in Lebanon. I admit I need to read up more on Lebanon to completely understand the situation. But what I'm going to say about Lebanon is they were a stable country for 30 years, and now they're having bigger problems than people in the United States. And maybe Americans are a little privileged, just in my view, to think, oh my, our problems are the worst of the worst. When there's countries like Lebanon, people are going to starve. That's what they're saying on that BBC article, because you can't afford to buy bread or dishwashing detergent even. That's how bad it's getting right now.
Well, I don't know how much longer we'll be able to buy bread or dishwashing liquid.
I know. I guess we should be honest too. Like, we will have some problems as well. But right now we have this false sense of security because of the stimulus at the moment.
Yeah. Yeah. So I have chickens and ducks, and so far they've been eating my food and I haven't gotten any eggs, but I'm hoping that very soon I'll get eggs to pay me back for taking care of them.
I think you will. And also too, like, you get the experience and you can make some really cool videos about them, which I think that will be a new addition of interest to your channel.
Yeah. Yeah, so I don't know, but I still am afraid that those of us who eat meat will be out of meat to eat very shortly. And yeah, because they're closing down all the slaughterhouses, and apparently right now the federal government is dealing with that by accusing the slaughterhouses or the packing houses of having a monopoly. But, you know, the government was the one who closed down all the small butcher shops.
Yeah, they were the ones that forced them to do that. But another thing I don't really understand with that is, like, why that's happening right now. Like, isn't this the worst time to be doing that, supposedly?
Well, I don't know. Some people say this whole thing is a coup. Yeah, the disease is real, but the solution to it is completely not helpful and intended to, play with our minds.
Oh, I think that they do play with your minds a bit, because, okay, I will be honest. I know that people can get COVID. I know that it's a real illness. But my question is, have as many people in our country actually died from it? Because we know there's some evidence that they are pressured, the doctors are pressured to put COVID-19 as a death, cause on death certificates. So I just question, like, is it as deadly as they tell us? I'm not saying people aren't getting it. I'm just wondering, are as many people dying from that specific cause as they say? Because we don't really have all the facts yet. I don't know.
Well, I mean, they closed down all the hospitals so people couldn't get treatment for ordinary illnesses. A lot of people didn't get their cancer treatments. And so a lot of people who work in the medical profession have actually been furloughed.
Wow. That's really kind of troubling, but I do find it problematic. I don't want to be like totally negative about what's going on, but I think we have to be a little bit more careful and not just say one side is correct and the other side is wrong. That's just my take on it. I don't know. But I'll leave it at that. I didn't mean to make it all about this, but I do think we should be aware that there are other countries suffering right now, and America's not the only country having problems. Just honestly.
Well, that's true. And I would like to know more about what's going on in Lebanon. And by the way, if anybody who is watching us right now, and we do have some people watching, do any of you know anybody who is Mongolian? Because our friend Kate Gladstone would like to do an episode about the Mongolian script, which is coming back. They switched to Cyrillic for a while, you know, the Russian alphabet. And now they're going back to Mongolian. If you are Mongolian yourself or know somebody who is, could you leave us a comment in chat so we can get in touch with you?
That would be great. I look forward to that if we can speak to a Mongolian speaker.
Yeah. Well, it might be a good time to sign off unless we had any comments from anybody other
than me. I don't see that we had any comments. I know we started out talking about children's books, but I did want to segue into what's happening currently, because I think if you're going to take your children to protest and you're going to talk about, well, this is the right side, that's the wrong side, and then it seems like there's only two sides, I think we have to be aware that there's many different people in this country. We're still all Americans. We shouldn't be. This is my main problem. I hate that one side says that they are more tolerant, but I'm hearing some really hateful comments from both sides. And then one side's like, no, we love everybody. Like, we're the good ones. They're the bad ones. But I'm hearing some really, like, not so good things. And it bothers me. I don't know.
Yeah, I think this is turning neighbor against neighbor, because people really have opposite views on almost everything, and now we're being very vocal about it.
You should be able to have an opinion. You should be able to be civil about it. Anybody can go to any protest they want. There is a problem when a protest starts having violence around me and people say, well, that was justified, that's okay. But then 3 weeks earlier, because you didn't like people protesting, they might be spreading the virus around. But these people aren't. You know what? The virus can still spread. I'm not saying it's as deadly as they think it is, because this keeps changing day to day to day, by the way. People do die from it, but I question if it's as deadly as they claim that it is. That's all. We need to learn more. And we can't say this is the absolute truth, because every other day they keep saying, well, this changed and that changed, and science evolves. It's not set in stone, is it?
Yeah, well, I mean, the way that we're being told this is very political. So, yeah. I mean, people need to protest. Okay, they need to protest, but each person has a different thing they want to protest. You can't say that only one set of people get to protest.
Yeah, no, you can't. And okay, it's still America, so we're going to stand up for the right of any American that wants to peacefully protest. They have the right to do that. I support that, whatever you want to protest. I personally don't want to go to any protest, and that doesn't mean that I'm not a good person, because that was another thing, too.
Sure.
Just before we end, just one more thing I want to say. Some people said that they can't post content on YouTube last week, because it wasn't important, and that they would be taking away from a certain social movement, and that's not fair. You don't get to tell people that they can't post, like, I don't know, a cleaning video. What if they're not political? You don't have
right.
And I don't think we should make people feel bad, any people. Nobody should feel bad. We need to be more, like, accepting of our individual differences instead of, like, divide and conquer. And I'm sorry that I keep going on, but just... who is behind divide and conquer? It's not good for our country. Stop doing it. But that's just my take on it.
Yes, I think we should be inclusive and not divisive. If we talk about prejudice, let's talk about all different kinds of prejudice and not just one kind. If we talk about the government murdering people, let's talk about all the people who were murdered by the government, not just some people.
Yeah.
And that way, everybody is in on it. Everybody is included.
Yes, of course. And everybody does matter. And
yeah.
I don't care what you say. I'm multi-ethnic. And you know what? I'm saying that. I'm not just a white person. So to people that say that just one group matter, everybody matters. But I will leave it there.
Okay. Yeah, and there are more groups than people know about, and there shouldn't be just a few protected classes, because everybody comes from someplace.
Exactly.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you for talking to me, Julia, and I will be sharing more information with you about my upcoming children's books.
I look forward to it. Have a good night, Aya.
Good night, Julia.